there was the ocean and the continent. And where the two were wed, abundance. To survive, he took from the land and the sea. Then more men came, and they, with their own idea of survival, took what they needed. Recently, remote, now central in a national search for resources. Alaska, blessed with a life that encourages individuals, nourishes friendship, and allows for trust. Yet, we live in a nation of progress, on the shores of change. Progress. What does it mean? And how will our lives be changed?
When you drive over that bluff into Homer and look over Kachemak Bay, I don't know of any other site like it.
And our employment, our whole economy is based on energy. Until we find alternatives, we're going to have to continue to look for oil and gas. So therefore, we can't quit that, in my opinion, whether it's OCS or state land such as Kachemak Bay.
You're not going to put an oil platform on Miami Beach or Waikiki Beach or in Yellowstone National Forest. And I classify this area as the same way. It's not the type of area that's compatible with heavy industrial development.
My name is Homer Burrell. I was director of oil and gas for the State Department of Natural Resources from 1968 till January of this year, 1975. And I was in that capacity, of course, at the time of the December 1973 Kachemak Bay oil and gas lease sale.
What do you mean by public planning? There was none because nobody knew anything was taking place.
There were a lot of newspaper articles on it, which I'm sure that the attorneys in the current litigation have explored heavily. There were legal notices put out on it, and the Alaska Land Lines, which is a monthly publication of the Division of Lands, told of it. And furthermore, there's a mailing list the Division of Lands maintains, which is free. Anybody can get on it. Mostly oil people are on it, though, because they're the ones that have the most interest.
I'm a crab fisherman in the bay. I fish the biggest portion of the year through the entire winter in the bay. About 2 weeks before the lease sale, we found ourselves with a lease sale. When we inquired, tried to find out what it was, where it was, we didn't get any answers. Finally, we did get a map that showed that it was to be in Kachemak Bay itself. In the outside bay where all the fishing is done, where where we have spawning areas for crab and shrimp both, about three different types of crab and several different types of shrimp.
Well, the total amount the state got in the sale was $24.8 million, and Standard Oil alone bid over $16 million for one tract.
I don't remember the man's name that made the statement. I'd hate to say for sure which one it was, but as a man that was in the know, and should have known, said that they weren't aware that there was a fisheries of any consequence in this area.
These waters out here bring in Kachemak Bay, bring into the area of Homer in Alaska as a whole $13.5 million every year in fisheries, from cannery workers to the fishermen themselves to supplying the boats. So for $25 million, the oil companies have this land for 15 years to go ahead and continue exploiting it and pulling it out and leaving the devastation that other communities are presently going through in Alaska. We didn't think it was any economic bargain.
We got together, put a petition to the people that had posted or had worked up the lease sale.
You can get public input, and you can, some of the, what I call preservationists want to continue having studies till the end of time, I think, sometimes.
And the petition was denied.
The state has some revenue needs, and there isn't going to be that much change. You've got to make some kind of a fish or cut bait decision.
Well, the petition was for a public hearing.
I was, as far as I know, the only one within the Department of Natural Resources that strongly urged the Commissioner of Natural Resources to hold a public hearing.
It wound up that we sent a letter to the lease sale notifying whoever bid on these leases that they were going to be contested, because we didn't know what we were going to do.
And I was obviously vetoed on that.
We didn't know how to do it.
On grounds there's no legal requirement to do so.
We didn't know anything other than we were mad, unhappy, disgruntled.
We start it now. We may be holding public hearings and everything that the Department of Natural Resources does in the future.
Didn't have any idea what in the world was coming off. And this was read at the lease sale. And from there, we finally did get a public hearing. The oil companies like to say that there's very little possibility of a disaster.
They kept on pointing to the environmental problems as we were bringing them up, and they were using as their source of information Louisiana shrimp and the Gulf of Mexico crude.
We're talking up here about king crab, tanna crab, Dungeness crab. I don't believe they have any of those species in the Gulf of Mexico.
We asked them if they had any studies done on Kachemak Bay shrimp, on Kachemak Bay shellfish, and Cook Inlet crude. The answer was no.
And I refer you to a booklet entitled Oil Spills and the Marine Environment by the Ford Foundation. I'll refer you to another one entitled Petroleum and the Marine Environment by the National Academy of Sciences. Neither one of which studies, they're both dated 74 or 75, neither one of which studies was financed by the oil industry in any way, by the way. They both say that oil spills from production are the least cause of oil spills.
If there's an oil spill in the bay, we're going to have a massive kill of marine life. There's no question about it.
Tankers are the major cause, and refineries, coastal refineries, and things of that nature.
So far, about everything they've done has either turned out to be a disaster for us or for them. From the first entry into the bay, I should start before the first entry into the bay with the George S. Ferris, which is a drilling rig. When the George Ferris came into the bay, I think I was the only one paid, but they came through a big clump of crab gear off Point Poughkeepsie. They took out seven of my pots. They paid me for the pots. I asked to be reimbursed for the crab that we'd lose off of those pots, at least for the period of time it took them to send me a check for the gear. I wasn't paid for that. Then on the second time they came into the bay, they had told us, they'd give us a warning when they were coming in, that the people, or that they would have a fisherman on board, that they'd have a helicopter in the air, and that they'd come in daylight. Well, they didn't give us any warning. They didn't have a helicopter in the air. When I met the rig, was about 4 or 5 miles off the Homer Spit. The helicopter was strapped down, just sitting there. The fisherman was still waiting for notification in Seldovia, and when I first saw him, it was pitch dark. So they came on in and hit gear again, which I understand they did pay two fishermen for 50% of their claim, possibly a third. Of other fishermen I know, from where I saw the rig, from the gear I saw hanging off the rig, had to have been hit. They didn't pay a thing and are now claiming that they aren't going to.
So it's a trade-off. You've got to decide. You can't let one little community call the shots on something that benefits the whole state. Or people in Fairbanks, probably, for instance, as an example, don't care too much about Kachemak Bay. They'd like to see the revenue. In other communities, I know the bush communities are certainly in need of revenue all the time, and that's where the money comes from. comes from these lease sales and the production of oil and the taxes and royalty on the oil after it's discovered.
No one has challenged the statement yet that this is the highest or the most productive marine environment in the world, the most productive bay in the world. If this bay is capable of producing like this, this 10 to 12 million pounds of shellfish and fish product a year, possibly more under more intensive management, but it's capable of producing like this probably from now until forever. As long as the environment is left undisturbed and we don't have a lot of pollution or other man-made influences.
Alaska is up for sale. The thing is, do we want to sell where we live?
Kachemak Bay, an example of the way development is occurring. Yet, is it the way it should occur? Are words like development and progress interchangeable, or does the meaning of progress depend upon one's job, interests, and personal values? What are these values, these interests, and how will a new industrial development affect them? These are questions facing any community on the shores of change. Whether it be oil, timber, tourism, or other forms of development, the answers to these questions from everyone in a community can predict how much a town will have to gain or to lose from economic growth. Development in its boom stage can bring more jobs and more business, higher wages, higher profits, more schools, highways, and public services, more entertainment, more people. But development is not for free and is accompanied by rent gouging and rising land values. Taxes for more schools, hospitals, utilities, and police escalate to serve the needs of a growing population. The young and middle-aged can keep pace with the rising prices, but those on fixed incomes, the elderly, what happens to them? As the hunters and fishermen increase, the wildlife diminishes. Business becomes brisk.
Competitors spring up overnight, it seems like. And also, you have the influx of your chain store operations. So in a way, the people in the area benefited as far as having a broader market and availability of goods come in. The other side of it is that you've had your local merchant or businessman that's been here for years and years, and suddenly he finds himself in a very competitive situation, and it forces him to take a good hard look at his own business and see whether he can keep up with the modern pace, so to speak.
Of necessity, there is a gradual change in the lifestyle of the community and the attitudes of the people. It could be for better or worse, depending upon what the community wants and who decides what the community wants. Those who invest their dreams and their lives in a town, or those who merely invest.
There will be a totally new type of community that will come into existence. When we talk about costs and benefits, we've got to distinguish between the community and the individuals within the community. Now, individuals within the communities will profit if they're in business, if they have certain land holdings, and so on. The community as a whole, however, will have to bear the cost of the impact of accommodating something that, in the magnitude of 100 times possibly the population they now have, the people who are now engaged in fishing will have to accommodate themselves to a smaller share of harbor facilities and support facilities. These are our costs. These are things that are difficult to measure in many cases, but they are definite costs.
Kenai was the first city in the state of Alaska that experienced oil impact, and it went from a community that had a population in 1960 of 650 people to the 1970 census, which was really after the boom, where we had 3,533. There were estimates that during the peak years in 69, 68 and there, that we may have had as much as 5,000 to 7,000 people. If you go back, say, to the 50s and use it, it was a very seasonal type of economy, and the people were used to working during the summer, fishing and whatever, then taking it easy during the rest of the year. What happened when the development came, the jobs, because of the hours and the pay scales, became very attractive to many of the local people in the labor market. And the older industries, or the previous industries, were hard-pressed in order to come up with the money, in order to be able to hire people on a competitive scale.
When we move to the state level, we can talk about broad principles. But I think it was G.B. Shaw that said once that the poor people can't afford principles. I think we can assume that there is some feeling that they would like to continue being fishing communities, but they would like to be able to be fishing communities with fish to be caught. If the fish have long since gone, they may be ready for a change. To remember that outer continental shelf development is merely a continuation of Alaska's oil and gas development. Anchorage is the capital or the headquarters of this development, so that the impacts will be very much what Anchorage has already experienced. During the construction phase, it will be comparable to the pipeline construction which they're now going through. But the big and lasting impact will be when production comes on. Anchorage will undoubtedly be the place where the platform workers will be rotated off their site to shore. This will be the place where dependents will be. This will be the place where the major backup will occur.
While new industry in one part of the state can have a strong impact on other areas of Alaska, the repetitive themes of quality, quantity, and our values as human beings accent the urgent importance of one question. What is progress?
Boy, that is a hard one, isn't it? Progress?
Progress has a lot to do with population. As the population increases, the people need services. Well, I've never seen such a big country with a transportation system so lousy. You know, everybody has to have a car, so then they have to buy oil. So then you get pollution, you say, okay, we have an energy shortage, we have to have a pipeline, and it just kind of goes back to itself, and I think it's mismanagement from the beginning.
Progress usually means going towards a goal, yet I don't really see anyone defining a goal to grow towards.
Today, as Alaskans, we weigh our natural bounty and human values against the pressures and maladies of the industrial world. Some say we can have development and keep the qualities in Alaska that we love. Others fear that development and our way of life may be incompatible. We can only look to other communities and to the Southern 48 and try to learn from their problems. Alaska, though awesome in its size and dazzling in a beauty far older than humanity, is not indestructible in the hands of man. In the next 10 years, a major earthquake of 7 Richter is expected in the oil lease area off Cape Yakutat. If there's an oil spill, can we contain it before it reaches nearby spawning and nesting areas? Mineral exploration and timber harvesting are rapidly expanding in Alaska. In what areas can clear cutting and salmon spawning coexist? Today, over three-fourths of the Alaskan people live within 50 miles of the seacoast. The Alaskan fishing fleet harvests approximately 114,000 tons of seafood annually, with an estimated value of $307 million per year. The world's population is soaring, and we must look to the sea for food. The estuarine areas of our shores equal or double the best upland farm areas in food productivity. And within the reaches of our continental shelves, the sea produces 15 to 20 times as much food as in the open ocean.
All these economic developments, all these community developments have an impact upon total ecological systems. Now, people make jokes about this sometimes. The oil industry is a little bit annoyed, understandably, because these things don't enter into their cost and benefit analysis.
But where we're looking at are the spawning areas of the salmon, of the wide-ranging fish, and the spawning areas in the life system in close to the shore. The intertidal area is the most crucial area.
We are not dealing with low risks, but with the highest in the world, food for ourselves, our children, and for other people.
It's not just Alaska, it's the nation and it's the world community we've got to look at when we talk about oil and we talk about fish. I think we're overwhelmed, or our thinking is overwhelmed by energy crisis here in this country. But looking at the world as a whole, the food crisis is much more critical. It's a matter of life and death, to put it very simply. A great deal is talked about, this is essential to maintain the American standard of living, that we've got to go out and get on the outer continental shelf. We've got to develop our energy resources. But what we're faced with now is going full bore in a very reckless fashion, draining resources that will not be here for our children, and possibly within our lifetime they may be drained out. And then what do we do, or what do our children do? We've got to take these things into account. As I say, it starts with a re-evaluation of our system of living, our ultimate values, and a redefinition of what we consider to be the, quote, American standard of living, unquote.
Change is constant, but not wholly uncontrollable. Some changes can be shaped if we try to suit our needs as well as those of our children. The comforts and benefits of development are many, but when a town cherishes its way of life and fears the changes unavoidable in the development of timber, real estate, or mineral resources, must they surrender the life they love? How do you weigh these issues? The balance between money and goods and a people's home. Alaska's spirit, its values, are hammered out and reflected by these decisions. Quality is the rarest of resources. At this time, a quality of life survives both in the hearts of Alaska's people and in the wild splendor of her land. Quality. A resource we should not sacrifice. That's what the Alaska Coastal Management Program is all about. An orderly process for making decisions about compatible uses of our coastline and ensuring that private individuals and representatives of local, statewide, and national interests are all included in the decision-making process. Coastal management, an alliance of local, state, and federal planners working with Alaskan communities to help them chart their own developmental course. The Alaska Coastal Management Program is a way to approach the question, what is progress?